Bubble Boy is a 2001 dark comedy directed by Blair Hayes. Jimmy was born without an immune system and is forced to live in a plastic dome. He wants to break free from his conservative household, so he embarks on a cross-country road trip in a plastic bubble. He is pursued by different stereotypes, including Mexican bikers, crazy cultists, and circus freaks. The film opened 13th at the box office and received negative reviews. Hey guys, and welcome to Garage Movie Reviews, where every week we just explore a random movie that's on my mind. Last week we talked about Fanny and Alexander, and I wanted to capture the same essence as Ingmar Bergman's Fanny and Alexander. I wanted something of the same artistic quality, which is why I picked the 2001 comedy Bubble Boy. Haha! Gotcha! Bubble Boy, regarded as a classic by me and me only. Let's just talk about the production of this movie, because the story behind the making of this movie is kind of as interesting as the movie itself. This movie, Bubble Boy, came out in 2001. It was actually inspired by a TV movie starring John Travolta called The Boy in the Plastic Bubble, which has a very similar premise, only the John Travolta movie is a serious film, whereas this is a flat-out comedy. That John Travolta movie was based off a real individual who was actually born without an immune system. The kid was born, he lived to the age of 12. At the age of 12, they attempted to do a bone marrow transplant, which didn't work out, unfortunately, and the poor 12-year-old kid died. So what I'm saying is that John Travolta movie was based off that real kid, and Bubble Boy is based off that John Travolta movie, which means this movie is basically a parody of a kid who friggin' died in real life. So no wonder why this movie didn't really get good reviews upon its release. It's kind of taking the death of a child and turning it into a farce.
Back in the 70s, we did put babies in bubbles, and that's how they were treated.
40 years ago, doctors called it a 1-in-1,000,000 disease.
I can't think of a more low-hanging fruit than that. But still, I'm kind of amazed at the fact this movie exists. Can you imagine the shitstorm that would happen in 2021 if a filmmaker actually made this movie? Sometimes, you know, when an idea is so terrible, I love watching the movie that comes out of it. But nonetheless, despite this movie being a little in poor taste, it's kind of got its charm to it, you know? It has a very early 2000s flair to it. They play Blink 182 and the doo boo boo doo 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 doo. I need something else to get me through this. Send me charm kind of life. They play like that kind of music, which makes it a little more charming to me anyway. It's the period I grew up in, I guess, was that fucking backwash 90s music. This movie stars a very young Jake Gyllenhaal. This movie came out in 2001. Spider-Man, the movie, came out in 2002. Jake Gyllenhaal was considered for the role of Peter Parker in that movie, which ended up going to Tobey Maguire, as we all know. I couldn't find this on the internet, but I can't help but think that poor Jake Gyllenhaal got rejected from Sam Raimi's Spider-Man and ended up making Bubble Boy. That's probably not what happened, but I like to think that's what happened. But I think Jake Gyllenhaal actually does a pretty good job in this. It's a more cartoony performance. It actually reminded me of Jake Gyllenhaal's performance in Spider-Man No Way Home, where he's a bit more goofy and cartoony and self-aware. And he does a lot of his own stunts in this. And granted, it's easy stunts to perform because he's protected by a giant plastic bubble. But he really enjoys flipping around in this movie. This movie constantly has Jake Gyllenhaal flipping around. You got other cast members in here, supporting cast, people that went on to do great things. Mr. Zach Galifianakis himself has a short part in this film. It's my first day out in the world! Unrecognizable because he is much younger. The great John Carroll Lynch, that's right, the Zodiac Killer himself, John Carroll Lynch, is in this movie, again, as a very small part. But the one small part everyone remembers from this movie is the great Beetlejuice. No, I'm not talking about Michael Keaton's Beetlejuice. I'm talking about Beetlejuice, motherfucker!
Spell red.
Red? L-S-T-E-R.
All right, is that your final answer?
My final answer.
All right. That, I think that's close enough, but all right, okay.
That's right. Beetlejuice from the Howard Stern Show is in this movie, and he delivers what I would say an Oscar-caliber performance in this film.
He's gonna hear ya! You gotta hide!
There's some scenes of obvious dubbing with Beetlejuice, because anyone who knows anything about Beetlejuice from the Howard Stern Show is that he can't repeat lines for shit.
No, I'm Beetlejuice.
I'm Beetlejuice.
Just about
to get late.
No, I'm Beetlejuice.
I'm Beetlejuice.
About to go into a seminar.
A seminar.
And I'm about to learn how to get laid.
And I'm about to learn to get laid. 6 months.
Trying to get Beetlejuice to repeat anything is pretty much next to impossible.
So most of his lines in here are dubbed. Not only that, but there's a part where they reuse the same shot twice. Probably because that was the only shot they were able to get of Beetlejuice doing this. So they reused it multiple times. And the director has such a fondness of the great Beetlejuice that at the end of this movie, once the credits are done scrolling, you actually hear Beetlejuice's voice.
Oh, look at this old
shotgun.
Shut up, chicken.
We'll never fit.
Whoop that ass!
So yeah, Beetlejuice is in this movie, which is partially, if not 100%, the reason why I wanted to watch this movie with my brother. My brother is a huge Beetlejuice fan. Whenever he's down or depressed, he pops Beetlejuice on. Just YouTube clips of random Beetlejuice moments. We're in the car when we used to drive from Quebec to Maine together. That's a 4-hour car ride. Beetlejuice the whole way. He would download a bunch of Beetlejuice clips beforehand and he would play them in the car. 4 hours of listening to a mentally challenged midget. But it was some of the greatest entertainment ever. What can I say? All right, let's stop talking about Beetlejuice. This movie has a lot of weird moments. It's a very weird movie. Jake Gyllenhaal's character Jimmy is obsessed with the TV show Land of the Lost, not to be mistaken with the Will Ferrell movie. But he's obsessed with Land of the Lost, and there's a scene in here where he has this kind of fantasy sequence where he's in one of the episodes of Land of the Lost, and they do some very 2001 Photoshop jobs.
Help!
Hang on! Hang on!
Ah!
Screw you, Grump!
Up on me.
Thanks for saving me, Mark. How do you do it?
Immunities, baby. Immunities.
There's this really weird scene. I saw this scene and I was just like, what the fuck was that? There's a scene where Jake Gyllenhaal pops a boner. And his family is very Christian, and they don't approve of erections because of that Christian household. So the mother tells him to pledge allegiance to the flag until his boner goes away. And what happens after that? A little incesty. Just a little incesty. A little uncomfortable for me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God.
Thanks, Mom.
Can't touch this. Can't touch this.
Can't touch. And what can you say about all the stereotypes in this movie? You can't make a 2001 comedy without a couple of stereotypes. But the fact that they do so many stereotypes, like if they just did one stereotype, it would be offensive. But they go after so many cultures in this movie to the point where it's just like, okay, they're just fucking making fun of everyone. They make fun of crazy religious people, crazy cultists. They make fun of circus freaks. There's a part where there's an Indian guy in this movie and he drives an ice cream truck. And you can just guess what the flavor ice cream is going to be. That's right. He sells curried flavored ice cream. That is so disrespectful. There's a part where he hits a cow with his car and he starts crying over the dead cow. Stereotypes. But no, it's not just Indians, it's the Chinese as well. There's a part here where Jake Gyllenhaal impersonates Chinese people.
You want $500?
Yes, I would. Please, I would like $500.
You want $500?
Yes, I want $500!
Somewhere out there, Jake Gyllenhaal's publicist is sweating profusely because a fucking YouTuber with 275 subscribers is unearthing a clip of Jake Gyllenhaal doing an offensive Chinese impression. The hardest laugh I got out of this movie was the part where they say that they're going to fake a Jewish ransom.
Mr. and Mrs. Livingston, we have kidnapped your son. Pay $100,000 or he dies. Signed, the Jews. Are you kidding? Are you kidding me? Who in their right mind is going to believe this note? It's the Jews, Morton! They're gonna want more than $100,000!
And that's what I mean. Every moment in here is offensive towards every culture. No one is safe when you go to watch this movie. And that's kind of the philosophy of comedies from the early 2000s. Let's poke fun of every culture so we can acknowledge all of our stereotypes and have a good chuckle at each other's expense. I think it's harmless entertainment, but I'm pretty sure that an online activist in 2021 would see this and get highly offended, which makes it all the more entertaining to watch for me in this time period. This movie is not good. Don't misunderstand me. This is not a good movie by any means. But it's just such a movie. I can't explain it. It's just such a movie. It's just so weird that this movie exists. It's like, what a colossal mess. They took the death of a 12-year-old boy who died a very tragic death and turned it to the most 2000s frat boy comedy. But somehow it works. I don't know what it is. It could just be because of Beetlejuice. It could be just because it has that kind of Nickelodeon kind of look to it where it's kind of cheeseball-y and a kind of greasy look to it. Like Jake Gyllenhaal's hair in it is very greasy and has the spikes and it's just such a product of its time, and I think that's why I enjoy this movie. We'll go with that. If anyone hates this movie, I can't really blame them. This movie is pretty trashy and dog shitty. But for some reason, this movie is like that weird cousin that kind of just picks his toes in public and acts very disgusting. You're revolted by it, but somehow you're just obsessed with it at the same time. Yeah, that's my review of Bubble Boy. Have you guys seen Bubble Boy? Did you guys grow up with Bubble Boy? I know this was a very prominent movie in some people's households. It's kind of regarded as a classic for that reason. Have you guys seen Bubble Boy? Did you enjoy it? Did you just get offended by it? Comment below, let me know. And guys, stay tuned in the Garage Movie Thoughts portion of this week's video. We're going to be listing off the top 10 Beetlejuice moments. Not the movie with Michael Keaton, Howard Stern's Beetlejuice. We're going to be talking about the greatest Beetlejuice moments. Hopefully you guys are there to talk about it, and I'll see you guys around.
Bubble Boy.